I'm Elliott SoRelle. We're here on Stanford campus in the Sherman Fairchild Science Building. I am but a lowly graduate student in Adam de la Zerda's lab. I grew up in Waco, Texas. It's a little town in central Texas. And both my parents are actually college professors, so I suppose I come by the academic track naturally. I played golf and basketball and baseball in high school. I was meticulous growing up, and I like things that fit together and make sense in a logical fashion, and when things don't on face value do that, I like to investigate them and figure out why. I had books on dinosaurs, books on snakes. What I'm doing now is chemistry. I make nanoparticles that create really unique signals in some different imaging technologies, and we're trying to use those for really sensitive and specific detection of markers of cancer and other diseases.
So those solutions that just look like red liquid is actually a bunch, like billions and billions and billions of these little particles. They're little rod-shaped gold particles. Like the reason you're seeing that signal is because of the particles. Like if I want to look at some cell surface receptor that's expressed by a particular type of cancer.
I think our lab has a pretty good culture. I think we have a decent sense of humor.
So do you know what this is, by the way? This is actually an electron microscope. So this is zooming down to those tiny, tiny, tiny secret agents I was telling you about before that are made of gold. They actually made some interesting shape there.
So it's a heart.
Yeah. Exactly.
You think?
In Adam's lab, we have a lot of different people with a lot of different expertise. And the strength of our lab lies in that diversity. I mean, it's a comfortable place to come into work every day because you know you have people who are fun and easy to get along with, and yet it's not all fun and games. They're very good at what they do. Well, my scientific career is young, but failure is probably responsible for most of it to date. I actually have go on, keep failing, only next time try to fail better, posted above my desk on a piece of tape that's holding an Eppendorf tube that contains a solution of the first batch of particles I ever made. And when I made these particles, they were okay, but I was so happy that the synthesis had worked. But I look back at the quality of those particles now, and they're awful by comparison. So it shows you, you know, if you keep working at something, if you keep trying to get better and better and better at something and not settling for some just marginal product, then that can go a long way to overall success. Success would be actively doing things that make either the world or the experience of it better for people. It's important if you very strongly have this idea of what you want to do, by all means pursue it. But if you are not sure, or if there are a couple possibilities, then you know, really allow yourself the ability to explore those. There are a lot of unanswered questions out there, and we'd like to think that we understand things pretty well, but in science, one thing that you learn is the more you think you understand something, the more you realize there is a lot of open ground that remains to be understood. What scientists do, which is sometimes an interesting way to think about it, is they say, I know I'm never going to be able to unlock all the secrets of the universe, but I'm still going to try.
Wow, every drop is the same. Oh, come on.
Is that the first stop or the second stop, Elliot?
Oh, that was first stop.
Masterful.
That was second stop.
Stay true to yourself, and that will take you a long way. Sometimes it may be a bumpy road, but if you are not true to yourself, then you're fooling yourself throughout, and you're going to end up somewhere you may not want. Force yourself to reach a goal that you know you can get. It just may not be easy to get it. Science is objectively good. It's a good thing. If science is your thing, you should do that.